to reciprocate, with an announcement of further American reinforcements expected within the next 48 hours.
This is the MBS Nightly News with Ted Phillips.
The year 1960. John F. Kennedy was elected President of the United States of America. A young Cassius Clay won gold at the Summer Olympics in Rome. And exactly 10 years ago today, the world witnessed the unveiling of another true American hero. A special report now from Jim Sizemore.
Thanks, Ted. Nobody will ever forget where they were on March 11, 1960. The day it was announced at the Gila Flats Test Base, Arizona, that the Superman exists and he's American. The world's press looked on in awe as the U.S. Army demonstrated the incredible powers of a man who could take apart a 60-ton Patton tank with a wave of his blue hand. His name, of course, is Dr. Manhattan. Little is known about the tragic accident that transformed a brilliant government scientist into the world's first and only super being. But one thing is certain, his powers are extraordinary. Teleportation, super strength, telekinesis, indestructibility. There seems to be no limit to what he is capable of. His ability to manipulate and synthesize matter at an atomic level has enabled incredible technological advances in the fields of renewable energy, national defense, and the space race. All have benefited from Dr. Manhattan's astonishing intellect and otherworldly abilities. And now, as a member of a recently formed group of masked adventurers, he has brought real superpower to a group of brave, ordinary men and women dedicated to fighting crime on our streets. Truly, Dr. Manhattan is a role model for young and old alike.
So, what are your thoughts on 10 years of Dr. Manhattan?
Well, now we've got God in our side, you know what I'm saying? It's the best thing ever happened to us.
Do you love him? He loves him. We all love him.
He's my little tank.
But to be honest, I don't think he thinks that he's real.
Better blue than red, man. Better blue than red.
So what next for America's Superman? With conflict escalating in Vietnam and President Nixon holding personal talks with Dr. Manhattan, could he hold the answer to the greatest problem of all? Vietnam.
It's hard to imagine the world without him, isn't it, Ted?
Absolutely, Jim. And so from everyone here at NBS Nightly News, we'd like to wish you a very happy birthday, Doc. We'll be back tomorrow at 6. Until then, good night.
This has been a color presentation of NBS Nightly News.
Superheroes as a concept are vigilantes using their morality to make a judgment about someone else. Who watches the Watchmen is thematic. Who guards the garters or who polices the police? Who decides whose morality is correct?
Look, Rorschach and I have made real headway on the gang problem by working together.
We can do so much more. We can save this world. It doesn't take a genius to see the world has problems.
Yeah, but it takes a room full of morons to think they're small enough for you to handle.
To take justice into your own hands, we're coming into a term which is known as vigilantism.
It generally happens in response to some sort of perceived threat to a community. Or some sort of sense that things are spinning wildly out of control.
I'm tired of being afraid. Afraid of war. Afraid of the mass killer.
This isn't a superhero story. This is an alternate history. This is what if somebody had the powers of a god? What would the world be like?
course, Watchmen is a product of its time. And at the time when it came out, I think it seemed that one of the major civil liberties issues of the future would be people acting on their own, vigilantes and other independent non-governmental actors.
1985, the crime was out of control. They were robbing, they were stealing, they were selling drugs in every corner. Crack was coming out.
And you would have to literally go through a phalanx of these thieves and robbers and modern day terrorists who would dominate whole areas of a city, a neighborhood, a street, a subway, a bus. And so you had to constantly watch your back, and you knew you were on your own.
New York City and certain places, you really took your life in your hands just walking a city block back then.
Back in the 80s, there was this real sense, I remember as a kid, that, oh, crime's out of control, things are getting worse.
It looks like the set from Escape from New York. You know, there's just smoke and rubble and armed gangs roaming the streets.
It's a funny thing that should have happened in the 80s, because of course the great vision of the 80s, Orwell's vision, was one of a police state where everybody was monitored all the time. The reality was very different. You were faced rather with an impotent state, a vanishing state, and the constant threat of riot and crime.
You see what takes place in the streets. You see anarchy. You see the breakdown of respect. You see there's no code of conduct. The philosophy of the Guardian Angels and what I tell all people is, you've got to do something. On the first patrols, people were terrified of us. They saw young blacks, Hispanics, Asians, whites. We would get onto the car of the train, and they would immediately exit stage left as quickly as their feet could carry us. And 5-0, the police were hell-bent on locking us up and throwing away the key. I mean, in the first few years, I got arrested 76 times myself.
Oh, you gotta join the gang, and the gang in my neighborhood were terrorizing the neighborhood. I didn't wanna be a part of a gang that was terrorizing the neighborhood. I wanna be the good guy.
When you were a teenage boy, you loved those guys. They didn't wait around for some kind of nanny state to take care of them. And they could kick ass like a criminal, except they weren't criminals, they were good guys.
We were physically trained. We must risk our life to stop a crime in progress. An average citizen, if they don't feel they're physically capable, must make noise, must make attention, must try to rally up the other citizens, even if it's from a safe distance. But you have to do something other than just call 911. To me, that is so weak. That is basically waving the flag of surrender, telling the criminals, if the police aren't around, you own this part of town.
If they take it upon themselves, instead of what they should do is call 911 and say, I think I'm observing a domestic disturbance, can the police come? And the police are just held to a higher standard of responsibility and accountability, which these individuals aren't.
Curse to us. Curse to myself, us. Four stand rush punch. Ray!
It's a complicated subject. It's not something that can be, you know, answered with a yes or no. It is not white or black. And for somebody to say that you always get involved, well, these are people that are not highly trained. Well, I take martial arts and I do this. All the martial arts aren't going to help you in the world if I have a 45.
We've taken down armed gunmen. We've taken down individuals who were firing weapons at the time. We've also, though, buried six Guardian Angels in the line of duty who were shot and killed or stabbed in the line of duty and then unfortunately gave their most precious gift, their life.
I know it sounds corny and I'm sorry, but I feel like I'm getting ready to do something. A lot of the guys feel quite pumped up when they throw on the uniform. Makes them feel like they're doing something important, something special.
Rorschach's Journal, October 12th, 1985. This city's afraid of me. I've seen its true face. The streets are extended gutters, and the gutters are full of blood. And when the drains finally scab over, all the vermin will drown. The accumulated filth of all their sex and murder will foam up around their waists. And all the whores and politicians will look up and shout, "Save us."
We accept in comic books that you put a costume on and go out into the night and fight crime, but really, why would you put a costume on? How would you fight crime? Would you just be a kind of an altruistic do-gooder, or would you have some other motive or some psychological flaw that made you do it?
Attention citizens, we are trying to maintain order. You must clear the streets until the police strike is over.
Superheroes are self-appointed authorities. These people are helping us most of the time, but what if someday they decide not to?
Our characters go out and again think they're doing really great things, but I think the comedian is a great example. When he's trying to control the riots, he ends up really beating up a lot of the people and then shooting them with rubber bullets. How far is too far?
How long can we keep this up?
Congress is pushing through some new bill that's gonna outlaw masks. Our days are numbered. Till then, it's like you always say, we're society's only protection.
They're I guess morality and their beliefs driving their behavior and getting them to vigilante, I think started to create disdain amongst the people.
You want my rights! You are not the law!
We want regular cops! No more vigilante!
They're all fundamentalists in a way. They see a threatening world where their only recourse is to take matters into their own hands.
What do you suggest we do about it?
Retribution.
Watchmen are over.
Says Tricky Dick.
Says me.
They're actually slight failures, these characters. You know, they were more heroic 10 years ago. They sat out with great ideals, and now they've kind of become compromised.
They didn't really have superpowers. They were just dudes wearing costumes. And it makes you think really, really hard about questions of ethics and morality in a way that we're sort of not used to, but Watchmen really forces us to.
They're criminals. They had intentions to commit crime. They should have realized there's a potential price to pay. They ran into the wrong guy at the wrong time.
If you think back, Bernard Goetz, the New York City vigilante, he really loomed large in the public consciousness. He was this enormously polarizing and to some really compelling figure.
It began on December 22nd, 1984, when four black youths approached the electronics expert on a subway and, according to Goetz, surrounded him and planned to rob him. He shot all four and escaped from the subway, but later surrendered to police.
When Bernard Goetz was the talk of the town 2 years ago, most of the talk proclaimed him hero. But now that the so-called subway gunman is on trial for attempted murder, it appears the tide of public opinion has turned against him.
Some people thought of him as a thug, an example of white rage gone amok. And some people thought of him as a private citizen who took justice into his own hands when the police wouldn't or couldn't do it.
Look at a case and the precipitatory factors to that case. And they say, look, this guy knew that by arming himself, he had the ability to take someone's life. He knew that by going into this situation, he was probably going to confront these individuals. He knew that when he used this verbiage, this wordage, when he caused these certain types of actions, he knew what was going to transpire. In other words, you're setting up the people. If you don't think that's going to come out in a court case, then you're sadly mistaken.
In English common law, there is a belief that before you use deadly force, you need to first show that you tried to retreat, that you had a duty to retreat. In American legal tradition, that doesn't really exist. And certainly as it's evolved into the 20th and 21st centuries, we've even gone further the other direction, where it is, we're to the point now where it's, if you feel like you're threatened, you can strike back with deadly force.
The jury apparently believed Goetz as they found him innocent on all charges except the illegal possession of the .38 caliber revolver he used. Again and again, he heard the words, "not guilty."
I think he did right.
He himself admitted that he set out to kill them.
And there was something incredibly strange and just fascinating and repellent about him. Somebody who was thinking about right and wrong. He was thinking about his own ass as well, but he was thinking about right and wrong and acting on it outside the protective cloak of a badge or any kind of institutional sponsorship.
I don't think he's guilty.
Why not?
Because he didn't really do anything wrong.
Now, eventually, it's going to be open season on anybody.
Rorschach, when he looks at the world, he sees everything in right or wrong. He does see himself as having this mission, sort of like Batman does, of eradicating evil, but Rorschach takes it a lot further. He assumes a lot more responsibility on his part. I mean, Batman catches criminals, and then he gives them to the police. Okay, he doesn't torture them, he doesn't kill them. Rorschach, on the other hand, uses a lot more extreme means to get what he wants.
Edgar William Jacoby, also known as Edgar William Bond, also known as Malek.
What are you talking about? I'm a retired businessman.
He's looking to simplify this world into black and white. For him, that complexity makes no sense.
It's funny that he's probably the most beloved character within the Watchmen world. But at the same time, he's probably the most psychotic.
They have this romanticized version of Rorschach because he, you know, he lives by his own code.
Because you want him to do harm to all those predators in society that you live vicariously through him. And you recognize he's going too far.
We're disgusted by his methods, but at the same time, if these are truly evil people he's doing it to, the little bit inside us that we may not want to recognize is going, yes.
You've watched this whole movie. You've watched, you know, the bad guy do all these horrible things. And all you want to do is just see him dead. Like, you want to, it's almost like you want to jump through the screen and kill him yourself.
Men get arrested. Blocks get put down.
Even in devoting his life to that, the police don't like him. Citizens don't like him. None of the Watchmen like him.
Good joke. Everybody laugh. Roll on snare drum. Curtains.
Through the 19th century, there are various examples you can find of vigilantism. Scholars will say that there is a noticeable uptick in violence after the Civil War. Civil War teaches people that if you believe a certain thing, then you just use force to achieve it.
You know, in the U.S., we typically have what we call the Trans-Mississippi West era, which most of us would refer to as the Old West.
In Missouri, literally the United States ends right there. They are so far on the edge of nowhere that there simply isn't any law enforcement.
We have now come into a modern era where you have laws throughout the United States, you have court systems throughout the United States.
There's an inherent distrust in the ability of the state, the government, what have you, to enforce the laws and to bring appropriate punishment where it's deserved.
Because what the vigilantes got, which they haven't got, is raw power, the power to deal out justice instantly.
Let me use the Bald Knobbers example. They were concerned that the government in the county was corrupt. And so they actually were attacking supporters of the government. At one point they said that this is a battle between barbarism and civilization. I would say in a vigilante situation, you have to have this kind of us versus them mentality. You have to be able to say, those people, okay, or the other. There has to be a distance of some kind.
There's a long history of vigilantism that is not well received by many because there's racial implications. Are you a homophobe? Are you a sadist? Why do you want to be cast in that light?
We were all attempting through our personal efforts to make our country a better and a safer place to live.
Clearly, Hollis Mason is a man who makes no apologies for the life he's lived or the decisions he's made. But is his own personal moral code enough justification for donning a mask and dispensing vigilante justice?
My primary mission in life is to protect the innocent and defenseless. And especially at this time in this world, with all the evil going on, all the wars going on, all the crime going on, that's why there's superheroes popping up everywhere. We're standing up for what we believe in.
The city is now a cesspool of vileness and needs expunged. There's so many people that turn a blind eye to what goes on around them. It makes me sick. And that's exactly why I'm doing what I'm doing.
Well, every kid, even in the worst of circumstances, even in a completely dysfunctional family, would like to be a superhero. But boy, that idealism, that degree of hero worship that overtakes you when you're so young can be knocked the hell out of you.
I was beaten a lot as a kid, and that motivated me to want to protect other people from living through that kind of stuff. I realized I could do a lot of good in this world protecting people, and that helped me understand my calling in life.
I was influenced heavily by my grandfather. He unfortunately was murdered out in front of his own house, and that's what really gave me the wake-up call to do what I'm doing today. So I've taken my personal vendetta, my revenge, my spite, my hate, my fueled anger, and I've bottled it into pure light.
I can understand the emotional and visceral satisfaction that one might get out of that. I understand that. But there are a number of different things that people have to be aware of. One, if it's a matter of going out and preventing crime, that's great. If it's a matter of being good witnesses, that's great. You can find yourself in a vigilante atmosphere getting in over your head, finding yourself in a situation that maybe at the outset you thought was one way, but upon further and complete investigation could be diametrically opposed to what you initially perceived it to be in the first place.
It depends on the situation. If I see someone being attacked, I'm gonna take that person, I'm gonna throw them off them like I've done before, and I'm gonna kick their ass, tell the other person to get away and call the cops. It's time to take action. That's what we need to do. The police can't be everywhere.
We step above that letter of the law. We don't have all that red tape that they have to go through. We're not bound by guidelines and rules like they are.
I mean, we do have a tradition of citizen arrest. You know, we do have neighborhoods that organize patrols and neighborhood watches. And these individuals are just taking it a little further, and they're doing it usually by themselves instead of an organized community effort.
I have never seen a costumed vigilante, although I understand that they do exist. All I can say about them is if those people were inspired in some way by Watchmen, I don't know if they really understood it. Possibly they didn't get to the end.
Some people have a very romantic notion of swooping in to save the damsel in distress, so to speak, and you can find yourself losing everything as a result. So I can come across a person, and I think that I'm gonna be the hero because I'm dressed up in a cape and everything else. Well, I got a guy here that just got out of the joint, he's got a joint build, knows what he's doing, and he doesn't care, and the next thing you know, you're dead.
Even with the very best of intentions, you could find yourself in some situations where you might be causing more problems than you were solving.
If I die in this line of work, I can actually die thinking that I've completed something.
There's a romanticism to vigilanteism in Hollywood, but there is absolutely nothing romantic about an autopsy.
When I hear about people doing this, I think, you know, that's actually a good thing to an extent.
So what you're looking at here is just some of the equipment. This is by no means all of it. that we not only train individuals in, that we have to learn how to operate. It kind of gives you a visual of what it takes in order to confront actual suspects out there that might be armed. You go in and you confront somebody and you think you have the situation under control, and suddenly, because suspects act in a very extemporaneous fashion, they can suddenly go from literally zero to 60 in a fraction of a second, and you have to respond accordingly. But there are also bounds that you have to operate within. And unless you're a trained professional, most people don't know what those bounds are.
It would take a superhero to stay morally staunch as a vigilante, and I've never met one.
Certainly we've had instances of police officers going too far, but they're investigated and they're disciplined if appropriate. No one's saying the system is perfect, but there are internal affairs departments that police do police themselves.
I mean, you sort of hope if you're a cop that all the cops out there are doing the same thing, fighting the same battles with the same sense of morality, the same code. And that's just not the way it happens. I guess you're part of a big fraternal order of police, but there's extortion and there are good cops and there are bad cops.
I gotta tell you, the temptations out there, particularly once you've established your credibility, are being thrown at you fast and furiously. It's like you're a rock star. It's like you're a rap star. And then you need to control your humongous ego because you need a crane to get it in and out of the room. And then that's when you decide to do things that you know are morally wrong and legally wrong. I must be right. I'm a guardian. I'm the one that people are depending on. And then that's when you begin to take advantage of it.
I'm anonymous for the times that I don't stay within the law. No one wants to be corrupt. No one wants to admit that corruption is rampant. But it is. There's a monster in everyone.
My allegiance is not to the law. My allegiance is to what is morally right.
I would contend vigilantism seldom turns out well. The moment at which you take a large step and a frequent step outside the legal, you know, the normal legal realm, it's not long before, you know, you've joined the criminals yourself. So, and you begin to do things and see yourself as bigger and above the law.
And that's what I've found with all vigilantes. They occupy a really dark and terrifying place.
What is it that someone does that makes them a hero? And are those things always as cut and dry and easy as they are in the movies?
There probably are people out there in the community who do heroic things, but who don't dress up, who don't announce themselves. Now, I think that would probably be my definition of a real-life superhero.
It's not one person's responsibility. No one person should have the authority to do that. And that's where Watch as the Watchman comes from, is if we have these self-appointed vigilantes going out and not just catching criminals, but they are appointing themselves as judge, jury, and executioner or punisher. And that's the whole Watch as the Watchman. If we appoint guardians or self-appointed guardians, who's going to guard them? Who's going to watch them?
When you have somebody who, and whether it's a vigilante, a superhero, or anybody who exercises power over another person, our natural assumption as sheep-like human beings is that person must be right. If they're exercising authority, they must be entitled to it. But the reality is there is no ground. There's just it's kind of an infinite regress of moral ambiguity. And the answer is nobody watches the Watchmen.